Hi, in this session, we will take a look at the toxic profile of two heavy metals that are a bit of a problem because whether it is deficiency or excess, each of these two heavy metals will cause problems. We have to be very careful that we don't end up with less than what is required or more than what is required. That is why I have titled this particular episode Less or More Problems Galore. The two heavy metals being copper and iron. So we were looking at in the other episodes common heavy metals that do not have any role with regard to health benefits. Their only problem is excess. Anything beyond a particular accepted level can cause problems. Deficiency, no issues. Metals like arsenic, mercury, lead. But when we come to these two metals, copper and iron, as I've said, there can be problems if you are deficient. There can be problems if there is excess. Let us take a look first at copper. Beautiful metal, kind of reddish with a golden hue. Copper is a normal constituent of the body, and that is an important point and a reason why it can cause health problems if there is deficiency. Because of its role in facilitating iron uptake, copper deficiency can produce anemia-like symptoms, neutropenia, bone abnormalities, hypopigmentation, impaired growth, increased incidence of infections, osteoporosis, hyperthyroidism, and abnormalities in glucose and cholesterol metabolism. Conversely, Wilson's disease, also called hepatolenticular degeneration, causes an accumulation of copper in the body and is a genetic disorder where there is excess copper in the body. It's a genetic disorder. So we will discuss a little bit more a while later, but suffice it to say that this particular disease to do with problems relating to copper accumulation in the body, mainly there are two kinds of manifestations. One, liver related, the other brain related. Liver related symptoms include vomiting, weakness, ascites, that is fluid accumulation in the abdomen, edema of lower limbs, that is swelling of lower limbs, and jaundice. There can be liver failure. Brain related symptoms include tremors, muscle stiffness, dysarthria, which is difficulty in articulation as far as speech is concerned, personality changes, and psychosis. We'll take a look at Wilson's disease with a little bit more detail a while later. But first, the metal itself, copper, brown colored, and as I said, normal constituent of the body. There are a number of derivatives which are important in toxicology, like copper arsenite, which is called Scheele's green, copper acetoarsenite, which is Paris green, copper subacetate, which is verdigris, and copper sulfate, which is blue vitriol. The first three are greenish in color, different shades, very nice to look at. I'll show you some images. Copper sulfate is of course brilliant blue, wonderful to look at. Each one of these is however very toxic. So nice to look at, but certainly not nice if you handle it carelessly. Then you have important alloys of copper like brass, which is an alloy of copper and zinc. Then there is bronze, which is an alloy of copper and tin. These are the important derivatives and alloys of copper. And some of these, as I said, are very toxic. Brass and bronze are more or less inert, so they don't generally cause any problems. Usual fatal dose, when one is asked, the figure that is given almost always relates to the commonest salt or derivative which is seen in toxicology, and that is copper sulfate. The range is 10 to 20 grams. These are the images of the various derivatives or salts of copper. Just look at this. Beautiful. You may have heard of 50 shades of gray. I'm showing you beautiful shades of green. At least three shades here. Copper arsenate, which is Scheele's green. Copper acetoarsenate, which is Paris green. Copper subacetate, which is verdigris. All three greenish, but different, you know, kinds of green. And then, of course, you have copper sulfate, blue vitriol. Look at the brilliant blue crystals. So, each of these looks nice, but all of them are pretty toxic. With regard to poisoning, if there has been acute overdose, or I should say acute ingestion of excess of any of these derivatives, there can be manifestations like muscle pain, myalgia, abdominal pain with vomiting, and the vomitus is characteristically bluish or greenish. An important point to remember, don't confuse it with bile, which is sometimes vomited out and that looks slightly greenish, but here it is quite distinctively green or blue depending on the salt. There is also diarrhea, severe acidosis, liver damage with jaundice, renal failure, all kinds of problems. Chronic poisoning can also cause, like all heavy metals, chronic poisoning is always a problem. You have a number of conditions that can result from chronic exposure to copper, like for instance vineyard sprayer's lung disease, sometimes mispronounced vineyard sprayer's lung disease. This is a condition that is seen in people who are engaged in the spraying of grape vines with copper sulfate. Main intention actually being to give the grapes a nice bluish green color. But what is said is that it is supposed to repel pests and grapes are protected. I really think it is to do with imparting artificial color more than anything else. Copper sulfate, as you know, looks nice and blue. So when you spray it in a particular concentration, the grapes look very attractively greenish blue. Vineyard sprayer's lung disease, because of constant exposure resulting from such spraying, results in gradual lung and liver damage with consequent manifestations. Then you have verdigris poisoning, which is seen in individuals who eat food that is mainly cooked in copper or brass vessels. As I have mentioned, brass is an alloy of copper, copper plus zinc. So when somebody eats chronically, always, food from such vessels, there is a possibility of copper poisoning, substrate, as a result of which there can be manifestations again, which are more or less the same as seen in the case of other copper salts like copper sulfate. Then you have Wilson's disease. We spoke about this a little earlier. It's also called hepatolenticular degeneration. It's an autosomal recessive genetic disorder. And the main thing that results from this condition is deficiency of ceruloplasmin, which is something that binds copper. So when that happens, there is a problem with copper regulation in the body and copper accumulation in tissues. It is called hepatolenticular because it affects mainly the liver and the brain, and particularly that part of the brain which contains a lenticular nucleus, that is a part of the basal ganglia, putamen and globus pallidus. combined together, we call it lenticular nucleus. There is degeneration of the liver and this part of the brain, and that's why it's called hepatolenticular degeneration. There is a liver, you know, failure and cirrhosis, all kinds of, you know, hepatic issues, and there is also a lot of problems relating to the central nervous system because of degeneration of basal ganglia. And one of the key diagnostic points to remember is a Kayser-Fleischer ring, which is a ring that is seen around the cornea in the eye, a kind of brownish or greenish colored ring at the rim or the margins of the cornea. I'll show you an image a little later. That can be often made out, in fact, with naked eye examination. Then coming to this problem where sometimes when swimming pool, you know, the water that is prone for algal, you know, contamination, copper chemicals are used to avoid that, usually copper sulfate. Sometimes when there is excess of this copper sulfate in the swimming pool water and somebody swims in that water, especially for a prolonged period of time, the hair can become greenish in color or slightly bluish in color, like the image here shown. This is of course a deliberately colored greenish. I'm just showing it to you because that is how the hair may look like when somebody swims in a swimming pool containing algicidal copper chemicals, especially copper sulfate. And if you know, this kind of swimming is done over a period of time, the hair can get gradually discolored. This is a Kayser-Fleischer ring. Just look at the arrow at the rim of the cornea of the eye. You can see a slightly brownish colored ring. That's very important and diagnostic for Wilson's disease. Coming to the diagnosis, to clinch the diagnosis, you have to look at the urine copper level, often elevated in Wilson's disease. And you can also look at, if possible, the serum ceruloplasmin level, where there is reduction. These are the two main points with regard to diagnosis. And treatment, you can do a stomach wash, if possible, with this salt that is mentioned here, potassium ferrocyanide. But if even if it is not available, that's fine. You can do a stomach wash with saline or water, and only an acute ingestion. Within maybe 2 to 3 hours of ingestion, you can undertake stomach wash. Chelation with the specific chelating agent is very beneficial, and that is penicillamine, also called cupramine. This is a chelating agent that is specific for copper, easily available in India. It can be given orally, and the usual dose is 2 gram per day for 7 to 10 days. Hemodialysis can also help in some cases, even though that is meant for those patients where renal failure is developing, and hemodialysis is not really effective for removing heavy metals from blood, including copper. Medical legal importance, most of the cases are accidental in nature, as I have, you know, shown you. Some of these salts are very attractive, and there can be pediatric poisoning if such salts are left lying around carelessly. And there can also be other instances of accidents, but suicidal poisoning is a bit of a problem in India with regard to especially copper sulfate, because it's easily available and it has a notorious reputation of causing death, even though the death is quite painful actually, because the mortality is so high. Copper sulfate as a means of committing suicide is unfortunately a little common in India. So that is with regard to copper, and we will move on to the second metal that can also have this, you know, issue of deficiency and excess, both resulting in symptoms or manifestations of illness. Iron, very common metal, silvery white in color. You all know it, everybody knows about this metal, it's so ubiquitous. Naturally, it occurs as what is referred as hematite or magnetite. And like copper, iron is also an essential element, and deficiency results in the characteristic hypochromic microcytic anemia. Commonest cause of anemia, in fact, in India is iron deficiency. We all know that. The other end of the spectrum, you have this hemochromatosis, which is to do with an inborn error, a genetic defect. Even normal dietary iron can cause toxic effects due to accumulation, something like copper accumulation resulting in Wilson's disease. Here it is hemochromatosis, also called bronze diabetes, because there is a problem with the insulin and the person becomes diabetic. There is damage to liver and heart also in this condition, and it is quite a problematic illness. Hemochromatosis, do remember, though results very often from this particular, inborn error or genetic defect, it can also result as a secondary phenomenon, like for instance, blood transfusion related hemochromatosis, which we call secondary hemochromatosis, also in severe hemolysis and conditions like that. And bronze diabetes, because the skin, the color becomes altered a little bit as a result of this condition, and the skin becomes highly tanned. So hemochromatosis or bronze diabetes, refer to the same condition of iron accumulation. With regard to sources of iron, what is required every day for each person usually can be obtained from the diet itself. As long as the diet is normal, all you require is about 10 to 20 milligram in an adult, and average diet will contain this much of iron. So don't really have to go for iron supplements. Iron supplements are reserved for those patients who are suffering from iron deficiency and have condition of anemia especially. Environmental sources. Important to remember, iron is found in 5.1% of the Earth's crust and happens to be the second most abundant metal and the fourth most abundant element, which raises the question as to which is the most abundant metal in the Earth's crust. This is a kind of general knowledge question. The answer is actually aluminium. But when you talk of element, it is oxygen, which is number one, followed by silicon, number two, followed by aluminium, number three, followed by iron, number four. So that's a bit of general knowledge for you. Coming to iron poisoning, when the serum iron level exceeds the total iron binding capacity, referred to as TIBC, which results in free circulating iron in the bloodstream, you get clinical features of iron toxicity comprising five stages. Stage one, about half an hour to 2 hours after exposure, with vomiting, hematemesis, that is vomiting of frank blood, abdominal pain, diarrhea. Often there is hematochezia, frank blood in the stools, not to be confused with melena, which is altered blood, which gives rise to the so-called tarry stools or blackish stools. So here you have hematochezia, blood-stained stools. There's also lethargy, shock, metabolic acidosis, etc. Then comes stage 2. And that is a treacherous stage because the patient appears to be recovering in this stage and may give rise to a false sense of security that everything is going to be all right. But not really. You have to observe the patient closely, because quite likely, if it's a serious case of exposure, the patient is going to go into stage 3, 2 to 12 hours after stage 1, where he is going to develop profound shock, severe acidosis, cyanosis, fever, hypotension, CNS depression, and metabolic acidosis. It's a life-threatening stage. If at all the person recovers from this stage, he will move on to stage 4, 2 to 4 days later. Hepatotoxicity is the hallmark of this stage, and there can be hepatic failure. Additional manifestations include convulsions, and coma is often present in stage 4. Then comes stage 5, if at all the patient recovers from the previous stages. This is a kind of a stage of recovery, but often there is, unfortunately, GI scarring, gastrointestinal scarring and strictures, because iron salts are mostly corrosive in nature and can give rise to pyloric or gastric scarring over a period of time, even if the patient recovers, and that has to be always kept in mind by the physician who is treating a case of iron poisoning. Diagnosis, there are many avenues. One is X-ray, of course, like in the case of every heavy metal, iron is also radiopaque, but do remember, iron preparations that are used as a tablets, tonic, etc., they may not be visualized on X-ray. Chewable iron tablets especially and liquid iron formulations are not radiopaque. Serum iron level is important to estimate. Poisoning is indicated if this exceeds 150 microgram per 100 ml. And if possible, you can do what is called a chelation challenge test to confirm. The antidote for iron, as we shall see a little while from now, is desferrioxamine, and this is actually given in the chelation challenge test in a dose of 25 mg per kg intramuscularly. If the serum iron has exceeded iron binding capacity, the excess iron will be chelated to the desferrioxamine, and this complex will be excreted as a reddish color in the urine, what we call van rosé, often mispronounced Winrose. It's van rosé, it's French, which means pinkish wine, or actually a form of red wine. The urine becomes discolored almost as if, you know, it is red wine. As you can see in this, an actual case of van rosé urine. Treatment of iron poisoning, if it is an acute ingestion, stomach washed with normal saline can be considered. But do not use desferrioxamine for the lavage. As mentioned in some textbooks, it is not useful and must not be wasted like that. Activated charcoal, of course, is ineffective, as in the case of all metals. It is said that magnesium hydroxide solution of 1%, if administered orally, can help reduce absorption of iron by precipitating the formation of ferrous hydroxide. So magnesium hydroxide solution can be considered, but be careful of the percentage, must not exceed 1%. The rest of it is to do with supportive and symptomatic measures. You should correct, you know, hypovolemia, metabolic acidosis, etc., which are likely to be present. Chelation therapy is the most important aspect of treatment of iron poisoning, like in the case of most heavy metals where there is a specific chelating agent. For iron, the specific agent is desferrioxamine, sometimes shortened to deferoxamine. There is also another related agent called deferiprone. Both are available in India. Desferrioxamine is more efficacious. It is given parenterally, whereas deferiprone, the advantage is it can be given orally, but it is not as effective. If this chelation therapy does not work, then you may have to undertake liver transplantation, because almost always in such serious cases, there will be hepatic failure. But as to whether this is going to work or not, is not certain. And liver transplantation, as we all know, is pretty expensive and not really easy to accomplish. So much of the time, it all depends on how quickly you diagnose a condition and how quickly you treat with a specific chelating agent. With regard to medico-legal importance, acute iron poisoning, unfortunately, is rising in incidence, and many such cases are actually tragic cases of accidental poisoning in young children, because the iron preparation that is used for treatment of anemia and commonly present, you know, in the household medicinal cabinet, many of these preparations in the form of syrups and tablets are brightly colored and pleasantly flavored. They are very attractive to children. I would say irresistible, fatal attraction. And many a case of accidental iron poisoning is a pediatric case, and very tragic because of this kind of situation where a child thinks that this is candy or this is some sort of a nice juice and consumes it. Look at the images of some, you know, iron preparations. Look at how attractively they are bottled, and if it is a tonic, and that is also, you know, going to be very pleasantly flavored. And if it's a capsule, you can see again how bright red, you know, this image shows that capsule to be, and also tablets looking almost like candy. So this kind of thing is something which should be discouraged, and the pharmaceutical company should formulate preparations which are not so attractive for children, because Though iron is beneficial in anemia and certainly must be given to patients suffering from iron deficiency, iron taken by a person who does not need it can lead to, as we have seen just now, serious toxicity and sometimes even death. So that is one aspect to be remembered in connection with iron. We have dealt with two very important metals in this episode, copper and iron, both of which have this paradoxical, you know, kind of feature that if you are deficient, you can have problems. If there is excess, you can again have problems. So it is very important to maintain a balance. That is all from me in this episode. Bye.